amongst you. This is a very interesting lecture, I believe, not because we put it together, but because of the content. We have this lecture based on a book. The name of the book is Happy for No Reason. And we intend to talk about how normal people, regular people, without the assets of a comfort, financial life, beauty and wonderful marriages, beautiful children, perfect lives, according to the media at least, can't truly consider themselves happy. The book does mention that they chose randomly 100 people. Better saying, not truly randomly. There was a research in those people who answered to consider themselves happy. They were the ones who were invited to be part of the research. So what they have found, that is basically 21 habits that these people, regular people, just like you and I, regular habits, they truly do on a regular basis, but five of them are very, very, very significant. And this book became a bestseller on the New York Times, and we do decide to speak about that. So I thank you for turning the lights off. But I'm going to ask you just to leave this here on, if you'll be so kind, and I'll later explain to you why. Can we enjoy perfect happiness? Thank you so much. We're going to just share with you a few questions and answers from the Spirits book, which is the foundation of Spiritism. And Kardec did ask the mentors of the Enlightened Spirits, of Spiritism, can we enjoy perfect happiness on Earth? And they truly, straightforward, say no. Life on Earth is a mix of trials and tribulation, but those are the good news. It's possible to be happy at a certain level, and that's truly the best news. This is entirely up to us. So it is entirely up to you and within your reach, meaning it's possible, it is possible to lighten your lot on Earth and to be happy as you can possibly be on Earth. Following that lecture, following that question, he does ask, so, all right, so what is the basis? What is the reference for us to be able to behave or to conduct ourselves in order to find this certain level of happiness? And before I give you the answer, I'd like to bring you the concept of natural law. According to Spiritism, natural laws are basically the assembly of all the laws of the universe, physical, non-physical, that are basically put by God to make us live and evolve in the best way possible. So the law of nature is the law of God. It is the only law, the only rule that ensures human happiness, since it reveals what, as human beings, you should do or not, and since you only suffer when you violate. So it seems like there is a law. When we get away from it, that will be the main cause of eventual suffering that we go through. So, okay, this is great, but if it is the law of God, we gotta understand, we gotta know it. How can we know it? So that's why Kardec does ask the following. Has God given us the means of knowing this law, after all? It's a fair question, right? And they say, all of you may know it, but not all of you will understand it. The ones who understand it best are those two types of people. Those who strive to live right, which means the person not even acknowledge God necessarily, You can be an ethical, good person just being an atheist, right? God has no religion. We're not going to be found ourselves better because we have this or that religion. But the religion does help us to enlighten and strengthen us in some way. So those who strive to live right and make the study of these laws, they make their studies the reason for being. So for you to understand these laws, for you at least know them, of course you gotta get a you gotta acknowledge their existence, first of all, and study them. So this is interesting because we live in the century of research. So when they heard this in the 19th century, okay, this is interesting, but some translations do say those who research it. And this is interesting because this is exactly what we are going to do today. We're going to present this research that is basically the study of happiness. It's called the Happiness Research, the Happy 100, and I'm speaking quite fast because I tried to condense this lecture, and I intend this lecture was presented in a seminar, and I tried to condense it, and I don't know how much I will be able to succeed. So I'm speaking a little bit faster, so stop later on. Stop me if I'm going too fast or if you do miss any point. So who is the Happy 100, like we just said? It's based on the book, The Happy For No Reason. 100 people were consulted in regards to the level of happiness. The pattern, they found out that they are not necessarily happy all the way, all the time, and they are not in levels of euphoria either. So not that they are always euphoric. The experience that was that happened, they mentioned to happen to in their lives. They experienced the underlying peace and well-being that is the essence of happiness, of true happiness, where you yourself bring happiness to your experiences, rather than trying to extracting happiness from them. It's a big difference. So the clear evidence that they found out, the happy people live their lives in a different way, that's for sure. Some of these people were born with a predisposition, if you can say, their personality are more optimistic. So yeah, they were simply born with a happy disposition. But what they have found, this is the most important part for us here today, that most of them learned to be happy by thinking and by living. And the way they did that, that now they are starting gathering the scientific data. The way the people live in a better way, first thing they notice is that the way they think and act truly affect the level of their experience in life. So they found out, this is the summary of the research, that our habits do affect our happiness. Habitual thoughts and behaviors create specific neural pathways in the wiring of our brains. In the same way, the water flowing downhill, for example, creates a groove on Earth. When we think or behave in a certain way, over and over and over again, this neural pathway is strengthened, and the groove becomes deeper. So they found out, they concluded, better saying, unhappy people tend to have more negative neural pathways. Their minds are literally stuck in a rut. So how do we know this? Based on what we come up with this information? Based on the science of neuroplasticity. So nowadays we know the brain is plastic, and this has been found out by the new technology. You can see literally in tomography the brain being rewired as you're looking at the computer and you ask the subject to think in different ways, to feel different. They show different pictures, different images. The person is feeling and thinking in different ways, and you see the neurons wiring and breaking apart. It's phenomenal to see the images, the tomography and the electric, what they call resonance. There are so many different types of tomography nowadays, different types of a brain scanning, but there are several different types using this research. So we know now that the way you think, the way you feel, the way you act will predetermine your future actions. And it's not easy to break this. It's not easy to break a habit. We all know this. Because the way we think and act strengthen that pathway. And to detach, to make literally, physically, the neurons to detach, you have to think and act and feel in a different way by decision. It will not happen in a naturally. So you have to work on it. But the good news is that we can change the outcome of our spontaneous thinking and spontaneous actions and most important, spontaneous emotions. We can re-educate, reprogram our minds, in other words. So the second data they have found, scientists used to think the neural pathway were set in some way, in stone. So in the past, about 10, 15, I would say not even 20 years ago, people did think that your brain was not mutable, was not plastic. So now we know by tomography, by all this new technology, that the way we think, feel, and act will rewire literally our brain a different way. So the good news is that we all have a certain level, a certain natural level of happiness. But you can reset this happiness point. This is good. So if you are not a born optimist, you can become a little better in that regard. And you all gonna benefit from this. You yourself and those who live with you. So the data number three, and this all came from, this information came from the University of Wisconsin Madison. The brain is plastic, so is the famous neuroplasticity, so well mentioned nowadays in so many articles and research. Based on what we think about the plasticity of the brain, we can think of happiness as a skill. This is tremendous information. So you can learn to be happy. This is the good news for 2017, for those who are not aware of this research. So this is no difference from learning a new musical instrument, for example. So we can train our minds to be happy. So what are the habits of these happy people? They consider themselves happy people. So the very first one, do not believe everything you think. Why is that? Because we tend to be negative. This is actually from our own evolution. If you're too optimistic in the cave time, you know, we're not going to be survive. We won't be able to survive as humanity, right? So there is a negative tendency that actually we're wired in our brains through evolution. When I get in touch with this research first time, I thought this data could not be possible. How can you possibly think about this? Is by the way, this is not by second, it's by day, right? So there is about 60,000 thoughts in a day. Sorry, guys, it's a typo. So how can you possibly think 60,000 different things in one day? Say, no, this cannot be right. 6,000 maybe, you know. But I did my own research. I put 1 minute and this start counting what different things I was thinking the very 30, 60 seconds. And I said, well, you know what? I think we can come to the, with that idea, one thought per second. But anyways, 90%, that's the interesting, actually dangerous part of it. We have so many thoughts in a day, but 90% of these, up to 95% of these thoughts are negative. And even worse, are the same thoughts that we thought yesterday and the day before. It's like we're not really original, right? So the majority is negative, and we keep thinking the same thing all over again. In other words, that's what it is, right? We keep thinking the same thing all over again, and then most of this thing is negative. Researchers from the National Institute of Health discovered that having negative thoughts, this is no surprise for anybody, I would say, can stimulate the areas of the brain involving depression and anxiety. But I really like to hear this. The good news, I'm full of good news and bad news in this lecture. So another good news is that not all our thoughts are true. This is a fact. How many times you anxious about something that never happens? So not all thoughts are actually true. There is what they call a negative bias ingrained in the human being. We are wired, hardwired, if you would, for negativity. For example, if you hear 10 compliments, if somebody says something bad about you, which one are you going to remember? That's all of us. You will focus on the bad, right or wrong? Right or not? Okay? So it's really interesting. And then they explain for a matter of adaptation through human evolution, we have an inborn tendency to register negative thoughts, feelings, and experience more deeply, register more deeply than the positive ones. So the good news, again, that we can change that. The happy 100 were skeptical, did not believe their negative thoughts, and have learned not to let false alarm hijack their happiness. So here you are, predisposed to get something going, and you started getting bombarded by different thoughts and emotions that are not necessarily positive. And then can take away all your excitement, all your motivation, right? Big time. And in Spiritism, there is one piece of information that they yet do not have. As we are hardwired for negativity, or we have this inborn tendency to be negative, we are also influenced by other minds that sometimes we just connect with them by affinity, by the same way we think we connect with them. But sometimes, unfortunately, there are souls out there, there are people in the spirit world, we call them spirits because they don't have the material body, that they have grievances in their heart towards us. And if they can find a way to mess up with our lives, they will. And we call this spiritual influence, actually, when it's bad, we call a disturbance. If it is very insistent, very, very insistent, we call it a spiritual obsession. So we really can go off route of success also by the interference of these spiritual minds. The habit number two, these happy people, they tend to notice the happy things in their lives, no matter how small. So they focus on the part that is good. So let's say, just a very simple example, you're going to work, it's rainy. What is the good thing about it? That you have a way to get there. Even better, you can, for most people, have some level of health. You even can move and see. So there are these small things that you could have a breakfast in the morning, you could afford to have a roof in your head, and other things. So it's truly a choice, isn't it? It's truly a choice. And if you don't start, mainly when we go through hard times, because we all go through, those are phases in our lives, right? When things are more difficult than others. So if you do not focus on the positive, things will tend to get worse big time. So there is a legend you hear even in, mainly in the internet, different versions of this story. But basically there is this Indian talking to his grandson, and they say, well, be aware of the wolves. Be aware of the wolves. There will always be two wolves trying to dominate your mind. And then the story, summarizing this story, the first wolf will be happiness. The second one symbolizes unhappiness. And the question that the Indian gives his grandson is, which wolf will win in your mind? Which one? Which one do you think? You have two wolves battling in a major battle in your mind. So which one is going to win?
Happy.
Okay. For those who know the answer, all right, the one you feed. Thank you. All right, this is great. All right, so many of us know the answer, right? So how many of us do put this in practice? How many of us are truly aware of this battle in our mind? There is a battlefield in our mind, and then can put us up or not. So confront, that's what they recommend, right? Confront the negative bias, right? Confront your natural tendency to think negative. Any positive thought you have, you feel, you taste, you entertain will give you some level of pleasure. And that's what these Happy 100 acknowledge doing their lives. They truly notice the good things in their lives. So I already kind of explained the negative bias, but physiologically, there is an explanation too. We do have a system in our brain that is called the reticular activating system. So for example, if I tell you here, why don't you notice the color brown in this room? And you're gonna start looking for it, you know, and you start noticing a color that, you know, most of this room here is almost white. So you start noticing, you start, okay, there is brown. Okay, a better example, let's say you want to buy a car, a new car. You know, you already chose the brand. Isn't that interesting that when you start driving, you start noticing that car that you're looking and thinking about buying everywhere? You see this car everywhere. See, oh my God, so many people are driving this model now. Isn't that interesting? So this is your brain calling your attention for something you already consider important. So let's use this actually characteristic of your own physical brain on your behalf. So when you seek to notice what is positive, your brain will make sure that you see that. So you need to be aware of this so you can start noticing and see the importance of being more positive. And your brain will help you to catch up. So you say, oh, I don't feel like that. Doesn't matter if you don't feel like that yet. Don't really doesn't matter at first to change this negativity tendency of ours. It's better that you do not wait for your emotions. You decide to be positive on purpose. You decide. You say, no, I will see what is more positive here. Challenge yourself to see the positive side of whatever situation. So if you acknowledge that, your brain will help you. At this point of being aware of our emotions, how our emotions can be our biggest enemy, and to use your brain, your ability to think, will eventually overcome your negative emotions. So do not wait for feeling happy. Decide to be happy. Your brain will help you noticing that. Your brain, as you insist on that, your brain start rewiring itself in a different way. We do have a limbic system in the very center of our brain. This is our second brain. It's where emotion is seated. And emotion is acknowledged by the body through different types of chemicals. There is a whole biochemistry of emotions, right? There is a whole science in the biochemistry of emotions. That's how you take medication for depression, for example. So they tweak here, they tweak there, that chemical here and there, and you start feeling better or not. So we can actually consciously also do that. So do not wait to feel positive. Decide to be positive. Your brain will help you. Your brain start rewiring, and eventually that emotion, more positive emotion will come up. But this is gonna take months of retraining. Months, because your whole life, you have been negative. So this, the second skin of yours is not gonna change all of a sudden, but you can do it, that's the good news. But anyways, habit number three. Wow, I'm doing great, my gosh, it's 7:35. This is the beginning of change for 2017. I feel so proud of myself. Oh, thank you. Anybody's gonna say, you know, congratulations, Livia. Thank you, please help me here. Oh, wow. Wow, I'm so close to end. I'm on habit number three, there is only five. Wow, stop talking. Okay, choose the happier thought. You know, they chose, these happy people, chose the happier thought. It's the classic, the very classic measure of optimism. There is a glass, you can either see this glass half full or half empty. So the next time you're having a negative self-defeating thought, search your mind for positive thoughts that are equally true. They gotta be true. Otherwise, you yourself are not gonna believe it, and that is not gonna become important. Your rest system is not gonna help you to notice, and that is a cascade downhill. So habit number four. Oh, wow, tend to your relationships. This is so, so very interesting as well. A score of studies have demonstrated that having good social relationships is often one of the strongest predictors of happiness. For women, relationships may even be more important. The University of California in Los Angeles, UCLA is University of California?
California, Los Angeles.
Yeah, California University, right. Though men and women are both release adrenaline and cortisol and under stress, a study shows that women also release a hormone called oxytocin. It's called the bonding hormone. The more women engage in bonding activities, the more oxytocin is released, producing a calming influence and further lowering the stress. So you see, we have this extra hormone that you guys don't have. I'm sorry, okay? So when we are stressed, what do? Get on the phone and get on the texting. Before, in the past, we used to talk. Now we just text. We talk in a different way, you know? So we bond. That helps us a lot. I'm sorry, guys, this is the negative, but you can also bond. You bond. Men tend to go to the cave. They love the cave. When they are stressed, they go to the...
thing.
It's a beautiful... It's a beautiful thing. But it's something. This is such a difference, and I like to say, to mention this in lectures as often as can possibly be, so the most amount of women can hear this, because we do not understand this reaction from men. We don't. If our loved one, your husband, your boyfriend, your significant other, if he is upset, he tends to be quiet, right? He tends to be very quiet and to withdraw. So what do? You go to this poor little creature and you go, what's wrong? Did I do something wrong? And start feeling guilty for something that you never did. And he goes, leave me alone, Leave the guy alone. Leave him in the cave. They love the cave. It's just like, I'm sorry, guys.
It's called the doghouse.
No, the doghouse is a different thing. That sometimes you all deserve to go there, but we're not talking this in public. As a matter of fact, I did ask our friend Luz not to streamline this lecture, because if I said something that, you know, a little off. So the doghouse, this is only be recorded, can be edited. You guys deserve. Big time sometimes. But anyways, so why is it important to know this trait in human personality, in men's and women's personality? It's completely different. Because this can be a major burden in our relationships. If you do not understand that your partner needs to be alone, he's only going to be out of that cave when he's feeling better. You will be bothering that person. You're going to feel guilty. Your life will be a turmoil with no need. When he's feeling better, he will come out of the cave. And you make him even happier. Okay? So he will come out, leave him alone. But women, in the other hand, they don't go to you, men, to bond. They go usually to their women friends. So to their girlfriends. So because we bond better, we nurture ourselves better. So just understanding this very simple trait can truly ease, put a major ease in our relationships, true or false? Big time. You understand how the other one reacts. So we are more evolved individuals, I have to say that. So we do have this extra hormone. So that helps. No, you guys are wonderful. You know, guys, what would be the world without men? You know, men are strong. The men are practical. Men are wonderful. Men are wonderful. I love that. You know, I love this sharing this information in public. We love you all, you guys. You guys are wonderful. We are better, but you guys are wonderful. Well, anyways, appreciation. Kidding apart. Jokes apart. So the best way. To keep your relationships happy, healthy, and supportive. So be appreciative of your partner. So you'll be able to bond. This is a chemical thing. It's naturally physical. So appreciate, show appreciation. When you demonstrate our appreciation for the support we receive from others, this reinforces that behavior and deepens our connection with those people. The social law is actually one of the natural laws, is acknowledging the Spirit's book. And I just want to bring to you quickly how much this is real, how much this is important. Social life is very important to human beings. We are not born to be isolated for anybody. So we should strive to get to that level. So last habit. Habit number 5, find your passion and your purpose. We all have a purpose in life. If you don't know it, if you don't know the purpose, if you don't know your purpose, research your soul. Seek in your soul. We all have passion for something. find what really is important for you. So bringing a sense of purpose will boost your happiness, so is finding your true passions. Passions are levers that increase our powers. Sorry, powers tenfold and aid us in accomplishing the divines of providence. This is from Allan Kardec. So thank you so very much for your attention. I hope that helped you to increase your motivation to make your life happier and have a happier 2017. Thank you so much.